Tonight I want to get back in the study of the book of Ephesians. It's been a while since we have been here, so I want you to open up to Ephesians chapter number 1. What we're going to do tonight is we're going to begin working our way through verses 15 through 23. I say begin because I'm not sure exactly how far that we will get. I don't think we're going to be quite as slow as we've been making our way through the first 14 verses, that it should begin to go just a little bit faster. But these are, as Brother Rick prayed, some of the richest verses in all of God's Word. And we need to understand what is written in the book of Ephesians as it applies for those of us who are followers of Jesus Christ. But Ephesians chapter 1, verse number 15, the Apostle Paul is writing, which is really a circular letter to a lot of different churches, but specifically for the believers that are located in the city of Ephesus, as we learn back in our introduction. But in verse 15, Paul says, "Therefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, so that the eyes of your understanding being enlightened." In other words, I don't want you just to understand this in your head. I want you to understand this in your heart. I want the theology of these verses to touch you emotionally and stir you. "Pray that the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand in heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, only in this age, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all." Now, we discovered in the first 14 verses that when you and I trusted Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior, we were born again. And when we were born again, we were born rich, because he talks about all the things in verses 1 through 14 that we have as the result of having a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus. We hear oftentimes about people and we say, well, they were born rich. But spiritually speaking, when you and I are born again, we are born rich. And we just don't understand sometimes the great spiritual wealth that belongs to us. And so the Apostle Paul comes back then in verses 15 through 23, and he prays this powerful prayer for the Ephesians that they might have an understanding of all of the riches that they have because of their personal relationship with Jesus. And I think sometimes that we just don't understand that, what is already ours. I think sometimes we're like the famous newspaper publisher, the guy William Randolph Hearst. He spent a small fortune on collecting art treasures from around the world. And he had several different warehouses that were filled with all of those art treasures. And one day he ran across several items and he said, "I've just got to have these." And so he called one of his agents into his office and he sent him on a worldwide expedition in order to find these items. He had spent about a year working on it, had spent a lot of time, spent a lot of money, and then he got back in touch with his boss and he said, "Finally, I have found them." And his boss asked him, "Well, where are they?" And he said, "I found them in your warehouse." Now, he spent all this time, spent all this money searching for all of these treasures, and they were lying right in his own warehouse. And if he had just taken the time to read the catalog of his treasures, he wouldn't have wasted all that time and all that money out looking for something that he already possessed. And I think that that is exactly what these verses are about. Paul is praying that they would understand the riches that were already in their possession. And when you and I just take the time to read the catalog, and see all the treasures that are ours in Christ, then what a great blessing and a joy that is to us. And it really, I think, keeps us away from theological heresy and a lot of other things that we're going to explain as we go on throughout these scriptures. But before we kind of begin to break down this prayer tonight, I want us to spend some time looking at verses 15 and 16, which is really the introduction of the entire prayer when he says, "Therefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers." So that's just the introduction to the text. And the first thing that we notice is what Paul heard. Paul said in verse 15, "I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ." Now, could there be a greater compliment said to us by someone else? "I heard about your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Somebody told me how Jesus had impacted you." And I think when he was talking about, "when I heard about your faith," he was not talking about necessarily how that the Ephesians were expressing their faith, but he was talking about their saving faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And the reason that people saw that faith is because there was evidence in the way that the Ephesians were living their life. So he said, "I have heard about your faith." Now, what was it that Paul had heard about the Ephesians? He had heard how they had trusted their Lord and Savior. Isn't that what verse 15 says? "I heard of your faith." Now, this is important. You might want to underscore this. "I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus." Not, "I heard of your faith in Jesus as your Savior," but, "I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus." So what Paul does here is he creates a very important doctrinal truth for us, and that is he links the Saviorhood of Jesus with the Lordship of Jesus. That little title there, Lord, speaks of Christ's deity, that he's God, but it also speaks of Christ's sovereignty, that he is ruler. So who is Jesus? Jesus is God. Who is Jesus? Jesus is ruler. And when Paul sums up his teaching in the latter part of this section, he emphasizes that the fact that Jesus was Lord and sovereign over all. Did you know that there is nowhere in the New Testament that we can turn where it separates the Saviorhood of Jesus and the Lordship of Jesus? I challenge you to find a verse anywhere that separates his Saviorhood and his Lordship. For example, in Romans chapter 10, verse number 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth, what? Somebody tell me, what? That Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. There the Bible links his Saviorhood with his Lordship. Over in Acts chapter 16, for example, at verse number 25, I'll just do this entire reading here. But at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, awaking from sleep and seeing the prison doors open, supposing the prisoners had fled, drew his sword and now was about to kill himself, but Paul called with a loud voice, saying, "Do yourself no harm, for we are all here." And then he called for a light. He ran in, fell down trembling before Paul and Silas, and he brought them out, and he said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Now here is a question that could be asked of anybody who wants to give their hearts to Christ, and it's the same answer that is given to everybody. So they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ." There it identifies his Saviorhood with his Lordship. And so that's a part of the nature of Christ. And you can't separate his nature of Saviorhood and Lordship. They always go together. Now, I am not saying that when you and I first trust Christ as our Savior, that we understand everything there is to understand about the person of Christ. I'm not saying that. We come to a greater understanding through the process that is called sanctification. The more that we grow in the Lord, the greater understanding that we have of who He is. But we do need to understand that we cannot accept Jesus as our Savior while at the same time not being willing to trust Him as our Lord. And I think that is something that sometimes when the gospel is being presented, whether it's in a public setting like a church service or whether it's in someone's home, that we always need to stress the importance of repentance, a turning from our sin and a yielding of ourselves to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. So as we grow and as we mature and as we're discipled and as we're developed, the greater understanding we have of who Jesus is, what He requires, and then we surrender that to Him. But when we come to Him initially, we must be willing not only to accept Him as our Savior so that we can go to heaven when we die, but yield to Him as the Lord of our life so that we can live for Him and we can bear fruit for Him. So what he heard was how they had trusted the Savior who was the Lord Jesus Christ. But not only did Paul hear how they had trusted the Savior, he also heard how they had treated the saints, how they had treated the saints. Verse 15, therefore I also heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus, and I also heard of your love for all the saints. As a matter of fact, I think that what he heard about their love for the saints was a genuine mark of their conversion. That was a genuine mark. You know, I don't think it's possible to come to know the sweet Lord Jesus in a personal way and not love those who are in the Lord Jesus's family. I think I've told you before that before I got saved, I didn't think a whole lot of those folks down at the First Baptist Church in Hilliard, Florida. I thought a lot of them were snoots and snobs and a lot of other untrue things. But after I came to know the Lord Jesus and I got to know them a little better, then I had a greater love for them. And so the very fact that he heard that they had a love for all the saints was a mark of their genuine conversion. In 1 John chapter 3, verse number 14, the Bible says, we know that we have passed from death unto life. Anybody know the rest of that verse? Because we love the brethren. And I could add the sistren as well. He who does not love his brother abides in death, that spiritual death. Whoever hates his brother is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. Now, boy, that's pretty strong language, isn't it? He who loves his brother has life, spiritual life, that's abiding in him. Have you ever heard someone say about someone else, well, you know, I love that person in the Lord. What does someone mean when they say, I love someone in the Lord? I really don't like him, but I love him because I'm commanded to love him. Now, how could you really do the lesser like someone if you don't do the greater and love them? I mean, can we really spiritualize love like that? And say, well, I love him, but don't like him, you know? I'm not so sure if God gives us the latitude to be able to do that. And so to love one another means to love like God. It means to love genuinely. It means to love sacrificially. As a matter of fact, did you know that a knowledge of theology is no substitute for love? I mean, I've known a whole lot of people who were straight as an arrow, were orthodox in their theology and what they knew in their head, and yet they did not have love for other believers within the body. And the proof that they did not have love is because they were never active, they were never faithful, they never supported the body with their spiritual gifts, they never poured into somebody else, which was proof that they really didn't care for anybody else within the body. And so just being orthodox in our beliefs is no substitute for genuine love. Isn't that what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 13? Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not love, I'm become sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I could remove mountains, but I have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. And so I think what Paul was saying, both in the letter to the Ephesians and the teaching of 1 Corinthians, is that love and theology always have to be balanced out. And if they're not balanced out, that's where we always get imbalanced and we end up in trouble. You know, throughout church history, the hermits and the monks, they have gone and camped out in the mountains and separated themselves from other people. And the reason they've done that is because they wanted to remain pure in their faith. And yet, their theology wasn't working, because if our theology does not cause us to reach out and be a blessing to others, what good is that theology? So Paul says, make sure that you're always balanced out. You see, dear friend, the love that we say that we have, true love, if it is God's love living in our hearts, it moves from our head and our heart to our hands and our feet. That's what true love is. Moves out of the head and the heart and moves down to the hands and to the feet. That's what Paul's, and that's what John said in back in 1 John chapter 3, verse 16. By this we know love, because he laid down his life for us. We also ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whosoever has this world's goods and sees his brother in need, shuts up his heart from him, how does the love of God abide in him? My little children, let us not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and in truth. Let us not just say, I love you, but let's prove when we say, I love you, that we really do love by what we do, our actions, and by our deeds. You probably know the old saying that to dwell above with those we love, that will be glory. But to dwell below with those we know, that's a different story. And yet we are to do that. That's one of the requirements of our Lord, is that we are to love one another. So what Paul heard, he heard how they trusted the Savior, and he heard how they treated the saints. But secondly, what Paul did. What Paul did is found in verse number 16, when he said, I do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. So he did two things. He gave thanks and he offered prayers. And I think that the giving of thanks and the offering of prayers was evidence of his love for them, because he thanked God for the brethren. You know, do we do that? Do we thank the Lord for those within the body of Christ that God has put in our path, that God has surrounded us with? Friend, I want to tell you what, I certainly don't know how I would live without Jesus, but I don't know how I would live without brothers and sisters in Christ. I mean that. Some of the greatest joys of my life are those times when people minister to me and when they uplift me in prayer. And Paul had a grateful heart. He thanked God for the body of Christ. But then he offered up his prayers. And when Paul said, I do not cease to pray for you, that convicts my heart, because when I think about how busy the Apostle Paul was, man, he was a missionary. He was always planting churches. He was always evangelizing the lost. He was always discipling the saved. He was always raising support for struggling churches. He was so busy every day of his life, and yet he still had time to spend time in prayer lifting up others to the Lord and their needs. And what was it that moved him to do that? It was his genuine love. And you know, that's something I've discovered that we can't just find on our own or be taught how to do. That is a gift from God. That's just something that God plants in our hearts once we are born again, right? All of you have experienced that. So he had the time to pray. I think there's nowhere really where it is said in the Scripture, but I think that Paul had a prayer list. I mean, when you read the conclusion of some of his epistles, Romans, he just names name after name after name after name after name, saying, I prayed for you. I prayed for you. I prayed for you. I prayed for you. Who's on my prayer list? You know, who is on your prayer list? I have two different prayer lists, the way they're divided up. I have a daily prayer list, and on that prayer list are my family members, my church, people in our church that are suffering with cancer and other diseases, particular needs in our church, individuals that I know of. That's my daily prayer list, and I lift those names up to the Lord on a daily basis. And there are others that I pray for weekly, like maybe some of the missionaries or, you know, some governmental authorities. But I divide it between a weekly list and a daily list. And that's the way that I keep up with my praying. If you tell me, Pastor, would you pray for me? And if I don't put your name on a list, I'm a human. I'm going to forget about that. And so I don't want to forget about that. I want to be able to pray for you. And I think that that is exactly what the Apostle Paul was doing here. And I think that when you sense how much love Paul had for those that he wrote these epistles to, you know, I've kind of asked myself the question, well, man, why did he love them like that? And I've come to the conclusion it was because he prayed for them like he prayed for them. It's really hard to dislike somebody you pray for. And if I find myself struggling in a relationship with somebody, I have found that the best cure for that is to start praying for them. And when I start praying for them, my perspective of them begins to change. And I'll begin to see them through the eyes of God. And I'll begin to pray for them like that. So something I always tell husbands and wives is, man, there may be a lot of things you don't do in your married life, but you ought to pray together. Because, man, it is hard to fight with your prayer partner. So make your spouse your prayer partner, you know? Make yourself a list that you can pray with together. And so that's the introduction. But now, beginning with verses 17 through 23, we begin actually to look into the heart of this prayer, one of the most powerful prayers in Scripture. And I think when we put all this stuff together that Paul was praying for, that we could sum it up by saying that the Apostle Paul was praying for their comprehension and for their appreciation. He was praying that they would comprehend and they would understand how magnificent and how unlimited the spiritual blessings were that they had because of their relationship to Jesus Christ. I honestly don't understand, when we read texts like this, how any believer could ever get bored in their walk with God. When we begin to understand all of the riches that are ours because of our relationship with Christ. And I think that what Paul was concerned with, and I can see his pastor's heart here, is that Paul was concerned that they be spared from the tragedy of always frantically searching for something else. He wanted them to understand who they were, what they had, so that they would not jump out on this dead-end search, always looking for something that wasn't there. Friend, in my ministry, I've encountered that so many times. Brother David Hecht, I'm sure as a pastor, you saw that many times in your ministry as well. I have seen the demise of believers who were not satisfied and content with what they got at conversion, so they were always looking for something else. And friend, I have seen people over and over and over and over again who were not satisfied and content with what they got at conversion because they never paid the price to study the Bible, to understand what they got at conversion. So they were on this great search, and the devil let them find something. But 9 times out of 10, what they found was something that wasn't of God. You know, friend, listen to me. Rather than seeking more than what you got when you were born again. You ought to live your life, and I ought to live my life, rather than me trying to get more and more and more and more and more of Jesus. I ought to live my life surrendering it to Him so He's getting more and more and more and more of me. See, that's the normal Christian life. Don't be discontent and dissatisfied with the normal Christian life, because God has given you so much wealth and so many riches because of your relationship with Him. So that's my challenge to me. I just want to live my life in such a way where I'm surrendering more of myself to Him, where I'm not always seeking more of Him, but I'm seeking to live in such a way where I'm giving more of myself to Him. See, that's the surrendered life that the great old theologians talked about. So he begins this prayer, I think, at the place of the most importance, and that is that they might know God. That was his first prayer, that they might know God. Verse 17, that the God, I do not cease to give thanks for you, verse 16, making mention of you in my prayer. And here is my first petition, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation. And by the way, the spirit of wisdom and revelation goes far beyond what we can just place in our minds. It goes to the point that only the Spirit of God can put something in our hearts. Friend, there is a great deal of difference between heart knowledge, heart understanding, and head knowledge. And it takes the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit. It takes us being filled with the Spirit in order for Him to do this. But He said, I'm praying in verse 17 that He may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. That is God. Now, why would you think He started here? Why would He start with this petition? God, I want them to know You. Why would He start there? Anybody want to offer up a suggestion? This is a classroom setting, so professor and student, give me an answer. Why would He start here? Why didn't He start with the riches of God's glory? You know, why didn't He start with God's mighty power? Why did He start here? I think it's because that's the greatest knowledge of all. And to experience knowing God. If we don't experience that, what good is anything else? The reason He starts here is primarily because nothing else is going to work if we try to bypass this point. You know, to know Him. I want to know Him in the power of His resurrection, the fellowship of His sufferings. Philippians 3, verse 10, one of my life verses. And so I want to tell you why He started here. Someone look up John 17:3. Rick, you look that verse up. Rachel, I want you to look up Philippians 3:10, and then we'll all read together 1 Corinthians 13, verses 9 through 12. So here's why he begins with the knowledge of God. Three things that encompass all of life. Number one is to know God personally is salvation. That's salvation. John 17:3. Brother Rick, read that real loud for us.
And this is eternal life, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, who now has sent.
What is eternal life? If I were to ask you that, how would you answer that before we read that verse? What's eternal life? It's to be forgiven of our sins. It's to be given the hope of heaven. No, eternal life is this. To know thee, the one true and living God, and His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. So to know God personally is salvation. But secondly, to know God increasingly is sanctification. Philippians 3:10. Rachel?
That I may know Him and the power of His resurrection, the fellowship of His suffering, being conformed to His death.
That I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings, being made conformable unto His death. Knowing God increasingly is sanctification. Is there more to being saved than simply walking down an aisle, praying a prayer, receiving the forgiveness of sins? Yes. Yes, there's more to it. It is not only to know God personally, but to know Him increasingly, right? Because we never know all we can know about Him the moment that we are saved. We are to increase in that knowledge. And that is the process of sanctification. So to know God personally is salvation. To know God increasingly, that's sanctification. And then to know God personally, perfectly, that is glorification. To know Him perfectly. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, again, verses 9 through 12, he talks about knowing God perfectly. For we know in part, for now we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect has come, what is that which is perfect? Jesus. For that which is perfect has come, that which is in part will be done away. When I was a child, I spoke as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see in a mirror darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I also am known. And now abideth faith, hope, and love, but the three greatest of these is love. That is knowing God perfectly. Now we, you know, see through a glass darkly. But that day when we are glorified, we're going to see perfectly. And I really don't know exactly what that means. I've heard the New Agers, you know, take a verse like that and make it almost sound like we're just going to become little gods. I think what that means is that we will know as much as it is possible for us to know as the creations of God. We're not going to be God, but we're going to know a whole lot more than we know right now. Amen? And aren't we all looking forward to that day? Kind of summed up in some of the songs that Brother Ken led us in tonight. So to know God perfectly is glorification. Why is it important for us to really get to know God? Whose image are we created in? God's. So the more we know about God, the more we know about ourselves. Friend, we don't need to run off to some secular psychologist, lay on the couch to understand who we are. The more we know and understand about God, in whose image we are created, the more that we will know and the more that we will understand about ourselves. And you know, all of this applies to saved people. An unsaved person does not know God. An unsaved person can know about God. An unsaved person can know about God by looking at creation. An unsaved person can know about God by reading the Bible's description of God. But an unsaved person cannot know God. Why is that? Because the only way that we know God is through His Son, right? The Lord Jesus Christ. He said to Philip, "You have seen me, you have seen the Father." Jesus came to reveal to us. He came as a man to reveal to us who God was and what God was like. So unsaved people can't know God. I don't know about you, but I really do want, and the older I get, the more convicted I become about this. Man, I really want to know God. I want to know everything about God that I possibly can know about God. I want to understand everything about His attributes that I possibly can understand about His attributes. You know, we sing that old hymn with pride sometimes. I need no other argument. I need no other plea. I only know that Jesus died and that He died for me. Well, friend, if that's all you know, you'll go to heaven ignorantly. It's good to know that Jesus died and that Jesus died for me, but there is a whole lot more to know after we come to know that Jesus died for us. And so He prayed that they might know God. Well, we didn't get as far as I thought we would tonight. Come back next Sunday night and we'll learn a little more. Would you stand, please, and we'll be dismissed. And Father, thank You for the gift of Your Word. Thank You, Father, for what Your Word does in our souls and in our spirits. Thank you, Father, that there is nothing in this old world that can satisfy our hunger like the living Word of God. And Father, I pray that out of these few verses that we examine tonight, that this week our challenge would be, oh God, we want to get to know you a little better. I pray that that would be the prayer of our hearts every day, and that we would seek to get to know you by our study of an application of your word. Father, I pray that we would understand that the only way that we can get to know you better is through your personal dealings with us and our response to you as you deal with us. Help us to know and understand tonight that every time you deal with us and we respond with obedient faith, that you reveal a little bit more about yourself. So God, we don't want to take it for granted when we hear a word from you and you speak to our hearts. God, we want to respond in obedient faith, because as we do so, you're going to continue to open up yourself to us that we might know you in a greater way. Thank you that you are a God that is not just distant, but Lord, you're imminent, you're right here, you're with us, and the joy of all joys is that we can know you. We praise your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
I'm so glad that you've chosen to tune in to our broadcast. And it's the prayer of my heart as you have walked into our worship center by way of television that you have been encouraged as you have listened to the great music that's been provided by our sanctuary choir and orchestra, and as you have listened to the instruction that has come from God's Word, that you really have been strengthened with something that will help you in your walk with God. And if you have yet to discover the wonderful gift of salvation that is provided to us through Jesus Christ our Lord, I pray that you might call upon His name.